गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णु गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुसाक्षात् परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। वी आर लुकिंग एट द समरी ऑफ चैप्टर 4 ज्ञान अज्ञान भेद कथना एंड वी सॉ दैट द ट्रुथ द रियलिटी इज अदर देन द ज्ञान वृत्ति एंड अज्ञान वृत्ति इट्स ट्रांसेंडेंटल अनअफेक्टेड अनटच्ड बाय नॉलेज एज वेल एज इग्नोरेंस नॉलेज बीइंग नथिंग बट अनदर एक्सप्रेशन ऑफ इग्नोरेंस अलोन एट द माइंड लेवल और रिलेटिव लेवल एंड दिस रियलिटी इज अदर देन इट देन इट सेड Both jnanam and ajnanam are only at the level of thought or vritti. So the first step is to counteract or nullify the vritti ajnanam with vritti jnanam. It's like you are pricked with a thorn on a dirt path and you got nothing else. Then what will you do? You will take another thorn and try to take the pierced thorn out of your foot. Exactly the same way. We have got a thorn called thought of ignorance. What do? You use the thorn of knowledge to take out the thorn of ignorance. And just as then both the thorns that we used were thrown away, we throw away the thorn of knowledge also. And in that manner, you understand what is knowledge. That knowledge is only you. Knowledge meaning thought knowledge. Thought knowledge is only used because you cannot calm down the thoughts by any other way. You can calm down the thoughts. Can you calm down the thoughts by traveling? No. Can you calm down the thoughts by eating? No. Can you? No. After eating, you know, when I eat, overeat, then I go to sleep, then I have calmed down the thoughts. But temporarily. So that is not a permanent solution. So thoughts have to be dealt with thoughts. Okay. And the staple diet of knowledge being ignorance, just the example that was taken before in this chapter was the diet of a flame is the oil, or the diet of the flame is the camphor. Camphor is lighted. It is eating that fire which is burning. It is eating away the camphor. And how long will the fire burn? As long as there is camphor to be consumed. So how long will the vritti jnanam continue? As long as there is thoughts of ignorance to be consumed. See? How long will we think of sleep? As long as the thought of sleep has the diet of thoughts of the waking. When the thoughts of the waking have completely been consumed, then the thought of the sleep also drops away. That's our experience, no, every night. Exactly the same way. Exactly the same way. But understand what we are trying to, Gnaneshwar Maharaj or Swamiji is telling here is, understand the principle. That this is how the mind functions. And this is how when, and this is happening in every way, in every aspect of your life, this is how it is working. The staple diet of knowledge being ignorance, as knowledge becomes more and more, ignorance becomes less and less. The fire becomes more and more, the fuel becomes less and less. Till at last, having sucked up the last drop of the oil of ignorance, the flame of knowledge or vritti jnanam gives a terminal burst and is extinguished. And this is our observation. You take a candle, you take the camphor, just when it's about to get extinguished, suddenly a burst of light comes. It appears larger than it was before, more brighter, and then very next moment it's gone. Therefore, only should, and thereafter what happens? So thought ignorance is checkmated by thought knowledge, and when thought of ignorance is consumed, thought knowledge also dies its own death. Thought knowledge will not come when the thoughts are about the variety. When the thoughts are about the world, then thought knowledge will not take place. Thought knowledge means what? Thought knowledge means thinking about the reality, having thoughts of who am I, having thoughts of the Lord, whichever way you put it. But then alone the thoughts of ignorance will be consumed. Otherwise not. If we are thinking that thinking about name and form is thought knowledge, again, we are going the wrong way. Then we are boosting the ignorance, that nothing else. And then what happens when both of them subside, both of them dissolve? Then Shuddha Jnanam. What is Shuddha Jnanam? Knowledge without thoughts. That is our true nature. Another word for knowledge without thoughts? Consciousness, pure consciousness, thought-free consciousness. See? Objectless awareness. What was the object before in our awareness? The thoughts. Now there are no thoughts, but you are still continuing. You cannot go out of existence. Consciousness doesn't go out of existence. Then what went out of existence? First, the thoughts of ignorance went out of our mind, out of existence. Then the thoughts of knowledge also went out of existence. But because the thoughts went away, you have not gone away, you continue. You were aware that the mind is becoming thinner and thinner and thinner and thinner. And if you can make yourself not to go to sleep, when the last thought drops away, there you are, objectless awareness. There the object is the thought and awareness is your nature. So at this moment, it's not objectless awareness. You are aware of the object of, and what is the object at this moment? Could be the screen in front of you, could be the sound that you are hearing, the satsang that you are hearing. So there is awareness of an object. Can we bring ourselves to a point where everything dissolves and you still are there? That's objectless awareness. And This is the maturity. This is wisdom. We must bring ourselves to our whole purpose of life is only for this. We are born only for this purpose. Who are you to tell us this? I'm not. The scriptures say so. And knowingly or unknowingly, we are pursuing that only, but in the wrong direction. When we come to the scriptures, we come to the right direction. And if we are coming closer, that means we are able to reduce the impact of thoughts in our mind on ourselves, meaning the awareness remains impact-free from the thoughts. What does it mean, remain impact-free? It remains untouched. How will it remain untouched? That you don't give value to it. As the vritti jnanam, you don't give value to the vritti ajnanam. What is, again, I'm repeating, vritti ajnanam is the names and forms. And as we are growing, now you observe in your own life, is your mind more agitated or has it become calm? Is it happy only when it gets something the way it wants, or is it happy for no reason? See? Does the mind accept everything as it is, or it needs a reason in order to accept everything? Is it argumentative? Is it under the spell of fear? Is it insecure? If it is going in all these directions, then it is ajnanam. Then we have lost the plot as we are growing. But if it is becoming calm, it is happy for no reason, it doesn't give opinions, it doesn't argue, the self-talk is reduced to a considerable extent. If at all the self-talk is there, it is about contemplation, it is about the stories of the Lord, it is about self-analysis. Then that self-analysis is called contemplation, nididhyasana. If it is moving in that direction, then we are maturing. See, then we are in tune with ourselves, we are in tune with nature. And these are the things to be observed in life. Otherwise, whole life, we are running away from something or running towards something. Kab rukegi gaadi fir? Therefore, only Shuddha Jnanam remains. What are the qualities of this pure knowledge? Meaning, what is the quality of this objectless awareness, which is our true nature? What have we done? We have taken the nature of the mind, which is names and forms, and superimposed it on our true nature. And we have started thinking, I am a man, I am a woman, I am a father, I am a daughter, I am a sister, I am rich, I am happy, and so on. All this is acquired, imagined, projected. But who are we truly? We explained just now. But what are its symptoms, or what are its qualities of this Shuddha Jnanam, Shuddha Chaitanya, objectless awareness, pure consciousness? Of this pure subject, which has got no object to perceive. They are, first, being subjective knowledge, it cannot be comprehended by any technique of objectification applied in gathering relative knowledge. So what is relative knowledge? Relative knowledge is that which is changing, that which is finite, that which is gained through the faculties. What are the faculties? The five senses, the mind, and the intellect, isn't it? And what do you gain through the five senses, mind, and intellect? And how do you come to know? only by way of thoughts. And that is relative knowledge. Knowledge by way of thoughts, where does it happen? It happens in the mind. What is mind? Nothing but consciousness. But you don't know that. Because your focus is on the mind. Just like you have forgotten that you are a man or a woman and you go around your whole life thinking and suffering as a man, husband or a wife or a parent or a child. But you forget that you are a man or a woman. So nobody is saying don't play those roles, but don't forget who you are originally. When you come to that, then you will realize, arre, even being man and woman is not important. Being Chaitanya, Shuddha Chaitanya is more important. Your experience of life will be where your attention is. So here, this subjective knowledge, this subject without a thought, how do you know the subject? As I. What are we talking about? Subject without a thought. Because thought is that which comes and goes. So even I am a body. Thought has gone away. I am talking. Again the I was born. I am speaking. Again the I is born. I am seeing. Again I is born. With every experience the I is being born. But do you feel you went away and you came again with every thought of I? No. Find out who is that. And that cannot be known through the thoughts. That which is the constant principle, that which is the unchanging principle, that which you are really, cannot be comprehended by any objective technique. Objective technique is necessarily only in the mind. Then what about yoga, pranayam, taking the name of the Lord? All that is to quieten the mind. Then you have to come to this point. What? That you have to, the objectless awareness. Go beyond vritti jnanam and vritti ajnanam. So when we are doing the vaikari madhyama pashyanti para, what are we doing? We are using the name of the Lord or the Om to checkmate the thoughts of the waking, to checkmate the thoughts of the dream, which is comes under the purview of ignorance, and to checkmate the thought of the absence of the two. See, the principle remains the same. So you may collect information about the whole world. Do you need to collect information about who you are? You are. Why do I need to collect information? No, I want to ask, what is your observation about my personality? You should know why you have to ask anyone. See? No, can you tell me if I'm alive or I'm dead? Can anyone else tell you? They'll put you in the asylum. I'm alive or dead. Only you know. You don't need to ask anyone. So am I conscious? Only you can tell whether you're conscious or not. But are you conscious of something or you are conscious full stop? See? So this truth, this pure consciousness, this Shuddha Jnanam cannot be gained by way of thoughts. Yato vacho nivartante aprapya manasa saha. Words cannot reveal it, mind cannot comprehend it. And where are the words? Only in the mind. And who is this? Just like the daylight cannot reveal and illuminate the sun. Why? The daylight is the sunlight. See? Just as a wave cannot ever come to know the infinite waters. But is wave not infinite waters? It is already the waters, but it doesn't know. Why? It has accepted its existence as name and form. So you are also essentially the pure consciousness. There's no question. You have understood that already. Then why is it not happening? It is happening all the time. That why is it not happening? You know, I want to just be one with it. Because of your obsession with the relative, your obsession with the objective. And the biggest, and that is, if that is also sorted out, my mind is empty, there's nothing there, then what is the problem? The problem is that same problem which Ramchandra ji had when he went into depression. What was that? Objectification of the self, objectification of the infinite reality, objectification of this pure consciousness. You cannot objectify the pure consciousness. The moment you objectify that pure consciousness which is your true nature, is interacted with the thought in your mind called pure consciousness, called reality, called objectless awareness. Our attention must be what those words are indicating. Just like the thought sleep is not equal to sleep, but the thought sleep is indicating a certain disposition, isn't it? And when you are available to that disposition, then the thought of sleep also goes away. You get absorbed into it because you are always, the objectification goes away. Same thing happens here also. Second, so first one, the way we interact with the world, this is a laptop, name and form. This is a lamp, name and form. This is a camera, name and form. This is a person, name and form. This knowledge, this way of gathering knowledge does not work in the realm of the reality, in the realm of your true self. Meaning objectification of the self will not lead, will not reveal the self that you essentially are. This is the first point. Second, limitation of the four speeches and the four planes of consciousness do not affect it. What are the four speeches? Vaikari Madhyama Pashanti Para. What are the four states of consciousnesses with respect to these four speeches? Vaikari is equal to waking, Madhyama is equal to dream, Pashyanti is equal to deep sleep, and Para is equal to Samadhi. So whether you are in waking state, dream state, deep sleep state, or Samadhi state is not equal to self-realization. Because these are, what is the quality of these states? They come and go. That which comes and goes is not the reality. All we have to do is recognize, that's all. And while I'm talking, while the satsang is going on, be aware of that principle, which is independent of these four states. At this moment, let the waking come and go. You know that you were sleeping also before. Who are you? Where is your attention? Are you accepting yourself as you are? Oh, that is wonderful information that I am beyond, that yes, waking, dream, deep sleep, samadhi, come and go. Who knows that these four states came and went? I do. Be that. You cannot stop the phenomena from functioning. Even after we come to be the pure consciousness, the waking, dream, deep sleep, samadhi will still continue to come and go. Question is, are you succumbing? Are you giving value to them? Or are you in yourself as yourself? Then the third one, it is without bheda. Bheda means differentiation. There is no knowingness in pure knowledge, and therefore there is no triputi of knower, known, knowledge. Mind is where the thought knowledge takes place, and thought knowledge only comes about if there is subject, object, and instrument of knowledge. And what is that? Aham, idam, and the instrument of knowledge. What is that? The knower, known, and the knowing. Seer, seen, and the seeing. Hearer, heard, and hearing. These three have to vanish. If you keep giving value to the seen, to the heard, to the tasted, to the thought, thinker, what is thinker doing? He is thinking, just like seer is seeing the seen. Thinker is thinking the thoughts. So we have to withdraw from the thoughts. Thoughts are about the whole, they will never end. We have to make a decision that enough, alam, enough, enough, enough. Because till now, before I was thinking about the world, now I'm thinking about scriptures all the time. But still it is thoughts only. Where am I going wrong? For so many years.
Alert from calendar, Mayday, Northern Territory. Alert from calendar.
For so many years, I've been thinking about talking, speaking, listening to the scriptures. Then why is it not clicking? Where am I going wrong in my approach? This is where we are going wrong in the approach. We are still thinking about the reality than being the reality. And thinking necessarily involves the triputi. Without the triputi, there is no mind. And who are you? You are not the thinker. You are not the contemplator. You are not the seeker. You are not the meditator. You are not the waker. Then who are you? You are that one indivisible self, indivisible consciousness, which has not broken into seer, seen, seeing, hearer, heard, hearing, knower, known, knowing, which has not broken into three. Now, make this clear that this is where we need to, this is what our true nature is. Not we have to get there. This is what our true nature is. And because of our obsession with this triputi, our obsession with the waking, dream, and deep sleep, meaning what is obsession with the waking? The waker, waking world, and waking experience. What does it include? It includes the body identification, then it includes the possessions, it includes the relations that is maintaining this waker, waking world and waking experience intact. And as long as you keep giving it value, importance, and find different ways to maintain that, how we are going to transcend the waking? It requires courage. It requires a deep resolve within our heart and mind. Because mind will keep trying to sabotage the whole thing. Because that is its nature to phenomena, name and form. We have to have this deep resolve that now enough is enough. I don't want to remain in this cyclical existence. Enough ho, kaafi ho, bahut ho gaya. So what is this pure consciousness? It is where no differences of any sort. What are the different, today we did that in the meditation. What are the different differences? They are vijatiya bhed, sajatiya bhed, and swagata bhed. Difference between species, differences within the species, and swagata, one unit of that species, within it also so many different differences are. So reduce the differences. Wisdom will dawn. Simple rule. Reduce the differences. Wisdom will dawn. You don't have to keep thinking, what are the differences? Are Baba, in your mind, different species of thoughts are there. No. Reduce the differences of thoughts. Wisdom will happen. What will be the ultimate? As we are different, how do you get sleep? All the thoughts which are creating differences, they are reducing. Then the last thought, which is of sleep, which is keeping you separate from sleep, that also gets dissolved. Then only sleep happens. And that's what we did before. Vritti jnanam removed the vritti jnanam, then vritti jnanam also dissolved itself. But here in this point, we are talking about the Triputi. Triputi, the knower known knowing, the seer seen seeing, these differences that I am someone with reference to something, this has to get out of your mind. Then what has to be take? What is the position then here? You take, you are all that there is, in spite of all the names and forms, in spite of all the thoughts. Here we are talking about thoughts because the Triputi is not out there in the world. Triputi is in your mind. So either you come to transcend the thoughts by dissolving them, or you come to a point where you are unaffected, udasin bhav towards the Triputi. Udasin, indifferent to the Triputi. Bring yourself to that. Fourth point, it cannot be brightened by knowledge nor dimmed by ignorance. It is beyond both. Thoughts cannot illuminate the self, the reality, the pure consciousness. So which thought, the waking thought or the dream thought, cannot illuminate the reality. And the deep sleep thought, it cannot dim, meaning it cannot cover the reality. Oh, but in deep sleep, I don't know myself. That is your stupid conclusion. How do you know there was sleep? Were you thinking in the sleep? No. Then after waking up, why do you say, I had a wonderful sleep? Someone was there in whose presence the sleep happened. That one is you. So that constant one, without whom, just like that constant sun, without the sun, day and night cannot happen. But is sun the day or is sun the night? No. So without this presence of pure consciousness, waking, dream, deep sleep, samadhi cannot happen. But is pure consciousness, waking, dream, deep sleep, samadhi? No. Then what are these waking, dream, deep sleep, samadhi? They are phenomena. Bring these examples and be. Don't get lost in over analysis of the example. Get the point straight away. Get the crux of it. What it is, what is being indicated through this example. So while we are saying that you are the one without whom you are, meaning you, the pure consciousness, are the one without whom the waking, dream, deep sleep, samadhi cannot happen. Now take yourself to be that one, to be that pure consciousness. What right now, rather than just merely seeing and listening, our attention should be, yeah, all the four states come and go. I have always been. I have not come and gone. So this pure reality, consciousness, is the light of all lights. Na tatra suryo bhati na chandra tarakam. It is that light which cannot be illuminated by any other light. Like the sun illumines the whole earth, but the eyes illuminate the sun. The mind illuminates the eyes. But can the mind, just as the eyes cannot illuminate the mind, so also the mind cannot illuminate its source, the pure consciousness. Recognize this. Understand the principle. No, but what about other people who are blind? Who cares? You work on yourself. It's your approach. Your own subjective approach. Don't generalize it. What will happen to other people? They are not there anyway. We are talking to each one of you at this present moment. You have to be subjective. Fifth point, nor can the terms existence and non-existence be applied to absolute knowledge. So this pure knowledge, the pure consciousness, the reality, the absolute self, the objectless awareness. Now, how have we talked about this essence? By these different words, we are calling it presence, we are calling it essence, we are calling it objective awareness, we are calling it self, absolute self, pure consciousness. All these are names. Where are these names appearing for that reality? In your mind. And these names are coming and going. And therefore it is said, nor can the terms existence and non-existence stick to this reality that you essentially are. No name can stick to it. Because name is necessarily only in the mind. And mind cannot comprehend the reality. But mind cannot express without the reality. being only relative concept, the word is and is not have no relevance. Existence, the word we call the reality as existence, consciousness, bliss. The word existence and non-existence. Why are we using those two words? So that they cancel away each other. Why we are using the word existence for reality? So that whatever is non-existing, what is non-existing? The mithya pratyaya, the phenomenal, to cancel it. Cancel, because that is what we are obsessed with at the moment. We are obsessed with that which does not exist. What is that? Names and forms. We are obsessed with that. We are running after that. We want to make ourselves secure with that. It can never. Then the scriptures have to bring in some other. Remember, vritti jnanam can cancel vritti ajnanam. So what is vritti? So we use the word vritti jnanam, existence, sat. So sat cancels asat. And when asat is completely removed, sat also goes away. Meaning the thought of sat goes away. But what sat is indicating, that remains. And what is it indicating? What is it indicating? You, in essence. Same way with chit. Chit is to cancel achit. And anand is to cancel dukkham. So all these words, nitya, shuddha, buddha, mukta. So nitya, anitya, shuddha, ashuddha, mukta, amukta. See? All these adjectives which are appropriated to the reality are only vritti jnanam, and they are used only to counteract the vritti ajnanam. So in other words, here it says, nor can the terms existence and non-existence. Now take it literally, existence, that which is, non-existence, that which is not, be applied to absolute knowledge. So you cannot say that the absolute knowledge, meaning the self, is and is not. Why? Come back to Keno Upanishad. The one who knows doesn't know, and the one who doesn't know doesn't know. But it is not that the one who doesn't know, yet he knows. It's a at the level of thoughts, at the level of mind. There we saw that only contradiction works. And what happens when contradictions are presented to the mind? The thoughts subside. And isn't this your knowledge also? You know you are. Is there any doubt that you are? No. Is there any doubt that you know waking, dream, deep sleep and samadhi have come and gone every day? No, there is no doubt. But this obsession that I am this body, is there any doubt? No, that is also not a doubt that I am the body. See, so which one are you? Are you the one which is other than the four states, or are you the one which is identified with the phenomenal? Which one? We have to dissect it. So there the student said, I know it very well. If you know it very well, you don't know it. Story over. How can you say that I don't know very well? Then teacher told him all that, and then he went and contemplated. Then he said, yeah, I know it. But I cannot say that I know it, but yet I know it. Tadeva tam brahmatamam vidhi. So never, with regards to reality, at the mind level, there can be no conclusion. It is or it is not. these options, mind means options. Mind means duality. So what is the ultimate? Is and is not. So mind can never come to a conclusion. But are you there because, are you existing because of the conclusion of the mind? Or are you in spite of the mind you are? That you have to determine. And that's why we come, and this clarity must be there with regards to your true nature. Mind is not your true nature. It's a phenomenal nature. Next, sixth point. If the doubt arises as to whether the absolute exists at all, since it is stated to be neither existence nor non-existence, the only answer can be find out who is having this doubt. Then is it there or is it not there? Who's asking this question? No. Oh, you know, that friend of mine living in England, he is asking that question. Okay, ask that question person to call me. It's not your problem, no? No, it's not my problem. Then be happy. Be. But you know what usually people do? They don't want to show that they are ignorant. So they generalize. Swamiji, what if there are people like this who are not able? Are you like that? No, then stop it. Why you go in that direction? You're going in that direction, possibility number one, that you are having doubt, you are ignorant about it, but you don't want to own it, accept it, so you are generalizing it. Second option, genuinely, you are concerned, means you are objective. What about other people? I want to realize with all the people together on this earth. Forget it. You will die the miserable death. But you realize yourself. You come to abide in your essential nature. The entire humanity will get realized. How? You are having all the challenges, doubts, seeking difficulties in the dream, but the moment you wake up, you realize, hey, it was only a dream. But when you woke up from the dream, every person in the dream also got realized because they were only an expression of your, a projection of your mind. Mind woke up. When mind woke up, everyone that he was projecting in the dream also woke up. Get out of this idea that you have to collective realization. Forget it. So if there is any doubt with regards to it, who asked the question about anything, about the reality also, even though there is no, but then what to do? Ask who is having the doubt, who is confused, who is seeking. The moment you come to the who, everything stops. If you become aware of the questioner, everything stops. Seventh, that which knows the presence and absence, that is pure knowledge. Don't you know presence and absence? Don't you know the presence of day and absence of day, which is called night? Yes. Don't you know the presence called waking and dream and absence of waking and dream? Yes. Don't you know the presence of breath and absence of breath? Yes. Don't you know the presence of vision and absence of vision when you close your eyes? Yes. Don't you know the presence of thoughts and absence of thoughts? Yes. Don't you know the presence of the I thought and the absence of I thought? Get to that point? And it is happening with every statement, every word that we speak, because we said, no, subject, object, and instrument, only then thought is created. So I thought is also coming and going. It gets illuminated when it expresses it. And when it is not there, you still are. So who are you? You are the one who is illuminating all the opposites. When you come to become very subjective, what is the principle? You are illuminating the presence of everything and the absence of everything that you are. Take this and sit. Contemplate. Let that be your thought throughout the day, whatever work is going on. I am the one. So you are the one who knows the presence of a thought as well as the absence of a thought. You are not the thought. Then if someone calls you gadha, donkey, then you will not be insulted. You will say, how did you come to know? That's another name of mine. Because no identification. You are illuminating. All names are my name. I am illuminating all the names. Dekho, we have to think in such manner. We have to think in such manner that we become free. Our mind becomes free. This is called healthy thinking, what we do in our satsang. This integrates us. This brings forth the true nature of ours. Every class is doing that. That which knows the presence and absence, that is pure knowledge, just as the sun. Sun is inert, okay? Sun is inert. But the sun god, he will know there is day and night. Same way. We are not inert. We are conscious being. And therefore, we are aware of the presence and absence of thoughts. Put collectively, put all the thoughts collectively, presence and absence. I'm aware of the presence of waking and dream, and I'm aware of the absence of waking and dream. Eighth point, words cannot reveal it. Yato vacho nivartante. Words cannot reveal the truth that I am. Why? Words are finite. Words are coming and going. But what about Satchidananda? We explained before. No? What about Nitya Shuddha Buddha Mukta Swarup? We told you. These are all words coming and going. I said it just now. It's already gone. Have you gone? No. So words cannot reveal it. It can only be experienced in the absence of absolute silence. What is absence of absolute silence? You can remove the presence of thoughts. What is the, when you remove the thoughts, then what is there? Absence, right? Is there something called absence? No. But sometimes those who are meditating, they are thinking, no, that you, there is nothing in my mind. What is that nothing? It's absence of all thoughts, absence of all name and form. But we are intelligent, no? So we are called it, it's absence. It's void. When we are able to remove the void also, when we are able to remove the absence also, oh my God, how is that possible? I can remove the presence of thoughts, but how do I remove the absence of absence? You're understanding what I'm saying? How can I remove the emptiness from emptiness? Are you playing with our mind? No. If you are able to remove the name and forms, if you are able to remove the waking and dream, now what is left? What is left? Nothing. That nothing, that emptiness, you call it deep sleep. You have given it a name. It's sleeping. But what is sleep? What is emptiness? What is nothingness? It is absence of something. There is not an object called nothing. It is removal of something which we have given it a name. Nothing. Oh, sorry. Removal of something which you have given it a name. Nothing. Now there is nothing. This hand is there. Now what is there? There is no hand. So what is there? There is nothing there. But you cannot go around, oh, there is nothing here, there is nothing here. You can't, nothing is always of something. Now imagine, but we are so intelligent, no? That the nothing also, we have made it into an object of experience. So on the seat of meditation, when Vaikari Madhyama Pashyanti Para, what are we doing? Vaikari and Madhyama, they are the waking and dream. When they are removed, what is the flip side of waking and dream? Deep sleep. How do you remove deep sleep? How do you bypass deep sleep? How do you transcend deep sleep? How do you transcend absence? But the only way is to make it absent. How do you make it absent? By coming back to yourself. If we are objective in our nature, if we are looking outwards, then there is presence, and removal of presence is called absence. In that absence, if we remain objective, eventually fear will come. But in that absence, if we become, who knows that there is nothing? You'll come back to yourself. This is called when absence becomes absent. You come back to the self. And that's what is told here. If that, where are we? It can only be experienced in the absolute of absolute silence. Absence of absolute silence. It's just words in that, because we have to put it in some way. Another way you can look at it is when everything is quiet, all the objectivity is gone. There is nothing there in your mind. And you say there is nothing, but there is still something going on in that silence. What is that? What is going on? the sound of silence is going on. Continuously it is going on. You have to go beyond that by asking the question, who is revealing, who is illuminating this? Because that is a soundless sound. You did not start it. You cannot remove it, because that's the sound of nature. That's the sound of universe. That's the sound of cosmos. What I am speaking is coming out of my mouth, but that continuous sound is the sound of the cosmos. It's like that Shruti at the back of the musician, continuously going on. That is the sound of silence. When we go beyond that, this thought came in the Bhagavata also. When we go beyond that, then we have transcended silence also. See? In Bhagavata, who went beyond that? Brahmaji, when he was born, when he came out of the navel of Narayana, this is the sound that he heard continuously. But because by nature, Brahmaji is extrovert, he's objective. Well, as his job description, as his job description. So what is my purpose? What is my purpose? He goes in, he meditates back. He comes to know his source, yet he doesn't know. Because, and in some places they say that the Narayana reveals himself to him. Other places they say that he knew and yet he didn't know. Just like our student in the Keno Upanishad. Then why am I here? What is my purpose? Then the inner voice, Narayana, because Narayana alone is expressing as Brahmaji through the conditioning of that form. So he says, do tapas. So what is the tapas? He listens to this sound. When he listens to this sound, then that unstruck sound, that sound of silence appears to him as a syllable Om in his mind. Then that Om became the Varnamala, and then the Vedas came. And then he knew what he had to do. See, we are taking the way back. He was coming outwards, we are going back inwards to our source. He came from the source and he didn't know what to do. We are out here, we are looking for the source. In fact, he also looked for the source, and the source revealed to him that while his existence is there in that particular form, what is the job that he has to do. But we have never done that. We became doctors, we became engineers, we became IT people, we became fathers, we became mothers. But we never came to know who we are. Jnaneshwar Maharaj, he came to know who he is. He never got into the rigmarole of any relationship. His only relationship was reality. Ramchandra ji, when he was 15, 16 years old, he had a breakdown. Vasishtha ji, Vishwamitra came, Yoga Vasishtha was told to him, he realized. In his case, his job description was different. He has taken birth for a particular purpose. That one reality has taken the avatar for a particular purpose. No, now I'm realized, why should I get married? No, he had no choice, it happened. But with whom? With Sita. Sita was also realized. So in which direction life is going to go? That is predetermined. Our goal is as quickly as possible come to know the essence, come to be the essence, and remain sakshi of whatever is going on. That's the name of the game. That is wisdom. That is undifferentiated knowledge. That is absolute self. Words cannot reveal it. It can only be experienced in the absence of absolute silence, that silence which is not the opponent of sound. Now see, if we are looking at nothingness, the opposite is something. If we are saying absence, the opposite is presence. Presence of something, absence of something. Now, which silence we are talking about? Absence of absence or absence of silence will be that absence which has got no opposite. And that is the pure self, which has got no opposite, which has got no competition, which has got no comparison, which cannot be equated with anything else. That is the self. See? Otherwise, we remain in absence and presence. Again, we keep flipping. Just like waking and dream are the presence, deep sleep is the silence. We'll keep flipping from one to the other. Sometimes presence, sometimes absence. Sometimes presence, sometimes absence. And same thing we do on the seat of meditation also. Sometimes presence, sometimes deep sleep or meditation. Again, waking and dream on one side and deep sleep and meditation on the other side. So these are two opposites happening. Meditation, samadhi happens only when you are in the world. Samadhi happens only when you are accepted that you are a being, as a seeker. Seeker means you are the body. Seeker means you still consider yourself separate from the reality. Therefore, you are meditating. And what happens in meditation? All thoughts dissolve. But how long? Temporarily. Deep sleep is all thoughts dissolve for how long? Temporarily. So waking and dream is the presence. Deep sleep and samadhi is the absence, relatively speaking. Then what is realization? Where we go beyond, from presence, we see this phenomena of presence and absence taking place, and we come to the absolute absence. Absolute shunya, which Buddha Bhagavan called as shunya, shunya. He is talking about the absolute shunya. Just as your eyes can never see themselves. So from vision point of view, because it cannot illuminate the source of the vision, it's shunya. There is no form there. But do you know that there is eyes? Yes. Right now, mind is thinking, mind is contemplating on the self. But can ever mind ever come to know the self? No. So does it mean that the self is not? No. That is absolute shunya. Because it cannot be known, relatively, meaning through the mind. Therefore, Buddha Bhagavan called it shunya, unknowable. Kenopanishad is also saying it's unknowable, but it is also saying it is the absolute knowable. See, Buddha Bhagavan took only one aspect of it. What he did, we don't know. We can only tell what they are writing. See. So don't. Come to a conclusion with regards to the essence of your being. Don't come to any conclusion. Think in the lines of the scriptures, think in the line of this great master, who is said, well, we are doing summary. And the summary is so beautifully put across to us seekers by Swamiji. There should be no ambiguity as regards to our true nature. Is it present? Is it absent? Is it presence? Is it absence? Or it is the absolute absence. That silence which is not the opponent of sound. Jnana varjita jnanahina chit jnanam asti kim jnanatum antaram. Oh, this is that tune. Jnana varjita jnana hina chet jnana mastikim jnatum antaram. This is from Upadesh Sar. So in conclusion here, Swamiji is writing, knowledge is consciousness. Transcending knowledge and ignorance, can this pure knowledge be other than the knower? So, what do we pursue? Whom do we inquire into? Don't inquire into the world. Don't inquire into the name and form. Then inquire the knower. Who knows whatever? Who is knowing? I. Inquire the I. Inquire the status of I, inquire the reality of I, inquire into the nature of I, free of all references. Not I is the brother. Why? Then that is with reference to sister. I is husband with reference to wife. No, free of all references. Inquire into the nature of the knower, the I. And there you are. For that commitment, sincere commitment, regularity of application, continuous awareness in and through all your activities. That is required. So with that, see, in meditation, what happens is we have come to know that we are the consciousness. Yeah, oh, wah, ha, ha, yeeha. Coming to where Jnaneshwar Maharaj is abiding, we have to know that mind with all its thoughts or absence of thoughts is also consciousness, the pure consciousness. Just like all the waves are necessarily water alone. Initially, we move away from the thoughts absence of thoughts and come to know. But then next part is that you have to know everything is nothing but the pure consciousness, the reality alone. Otherwise, it will be only half. That is a joke. Half a realization. Realization never half. And neither it is full, because it is always. Full is opposite of half. Full is a measure. Reality is not a measure. It is our natural state. With that, we conclude the fourth chapter. And now we begin the fifth chapter, Satchitananda Padatrayi Vivarana, Evaluation and Inadequacies of the Term Satchit Ananda. I just touched it in one of the points there. And what is that? This chapter will be about inquiring into the validity of calling the reality as Sat Chit Ananda. That these words, Sat Chit Ananda, are technically an abuse to that reality. Any word used, not only Satchidananda, but also Nitya, Shuddha, Buddha, Mukta, Swarupa, Ekameva Dvitiya, Sarvam Khalvidam Brahma, whatever word you use, words by nature are finite. And when a finite word is used to indicate the reality, it is blasphemy. It is a sin. It is a abuse. Why we are using these words, such strong words, blasphemy, abuse, sin, so that it goes deep into you not to take the support of the words to to accept the reality. You have to accept the reality as it is, and that is only possible when you take it as the subject that you are. When you don't take yourself to be it, then you need words to communicate. You need words to convince. You need words to reveal. You need words to become focused, single-pointed. Why? Words are required because you have not accepted it to be you, in essence. Oh, but are we not using these words to cancel the words of ignorance of the names and forms? Yeah, all that is good. Now we are coming to the next stage. You have cancelled vritti ajnanam with vritti jnanam. And what is vritti jnanam? That all these words, satchit, anand, nitya, shuddha, muddha, mukta, duru. Now even these have to go away. Otherwise, not this lifetime, but many lifetimes of habit of objectifying the reality will continue. And objectification of the reality continues by way of words. And somewhere, somehow, you are attracted to, you are able to sit for 1.5 hours listening to that which cannot be known by the words or by the mind. Isn't it funny? I am speaking about that which cannot be revealed. Isn't that funny? And yet, you are listening intently, sincerely. I am also speaking about it again and again and again and again. This is the conundrum. This is the wonderment that it is not your ability to understand and my ability to speak. It is not these two which are keeping us focused for 1.5 hours. It is not the words which are keeping us alert for 1.5 hours. I'm talking to those who are alert, because others I can't see. So what is keeping us focused? What is keeping us alert? What is giving us, making us be available for 1.5 hours? Somewhere something is taking place. And what is that? The contact of consciousness with consciousness. The consciousness on which these words are riding, and the consciousness because of which the words are being heard. Somewhere, knowingly or unknowingly, you are interested in that consciousness. And words are continuously reminding that you are that consciousness. And that is the nourishment. And when nourishment is there, we are available. And automatically, the body is still, the mind is focused. Even if distractions are there, we are not getting distracted. See. So the next stage, so in the previous chapter, what did we do? We removed the differences. How did we remove the differences? By vritti jnana, removed the vritti ajnana. In other words, being aware, contemplating on who am I, the subject, just as contemplating on the sleep removed all the thoughts of the waking. You didn't remove it. They went away by themselves. Vritti ajnanam. So contemplating on the I, who am I am that which is ever, which is always, which is never coming and going. So the more we remain with it, to that extent, all the idam, all the other thoughts become null and void, become impotent, go away. Now what is remaining? I. Then who am I? The mind will throw, because it has studied for so many years, it has studied the scriptures. Who is I? Oh, I is Satchidanand. I am ever existing. I am all knowing and I am bliss incarnate. Gone. Gone. The next pitfall. So when you have come to be the I, where do you come to be the I? In meditation. Isn't it? You have got no doubt, because mind has become empty. I told you, waking and dream on one side, the presence, and deep sleep and meditation, the other side, the absence. So what is absent? But it is at relative level. So what is absent? All the thoughts are absent in the deep sleep, and all the idam is absent in the meditation also. Now the next stage, because meditation is continuing, you're going in and coming out and coming in and going out. Somewhere something is going wrong. How do I transcend this shunting business? How do I stop this objectification? It is the objectification which is making me go into meditation and come out of meditation. It is the objectification. The objective approach to the reality, to the self. Objective approach to who am I? And who am I? Okay, you are Satchidanand Swarup. But now the teacher takes the next stage, next approach, that these adjectives of Satchidanand do not stick to the self that you are. But these are good thoughts. So when we do say discrimination, discrimination means nitya nitya vivek, discrimination between the constant and the changing. So who is constant? I is constant, but it is still a thought for you. What is the nature of this I? Oh, you are not the one who is old and who is young or who is sick, happy or sad or hungry or thirsty. No, no, you are Satchidanand Swarup. Why was the Satchidanand Swarup introduced? So that all other identifications that you had taken on could be dissolved. So now that is dissolved on the seat of meditation, but Satchidanand Swarup is still staying there. That also needs to be dissolved. And how to dissolve that? That is the topic of our next chapter, that these terms that have been used are only to cancel the opposite. Sat is used to cancel asat, chit is used to cancel achit, anand is used to cancel dukkham. And what is the, how the chapter unfolds, will begin with this introduction. Swamiji also will give an introduction. Let's see. This is my little bit of it, of my understanding and my conduct. Not my conduct. It happened at this moment. What my am doing. And we'll start the chapter in our next class. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Hari Om. Is it silence for a few minutes, seconds?